one of us in this 5 a.m. prayer. He's married to my director there in the Cape Conference, Sister Nomthandazo Papu. They've got two adult children, boys, and we are so pleased to have you, Dr. Papu. It's always a pleasure to sit under your feet, like a servant sitting under their master, listening to the word of God. I give you extra 5 minutes, Dr. Papu, since we had taken some time. Thank you. The time is yours.
Thank you very much, Sizoda, and good morning to everyone. Let me see if I can share. Now, I don't know whether this is coming out. Is it coming out?
Yeah, we can see some of the things that you are trying to do.
Wait. Okay.
Should we give you some time?
Yep, we got it. We should be there now.
Praise the Lord, it's there.
Do you see what I see?
Yes, steps to Christ.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you very much. Apologies for that delay there. So good morning, everyone. Our theme for this week is Steps to Christ and the booklet, Steps to Christ, which was written almost 100 years ago. What is in the booklet is still as important as it was then. So let's see, just as an introduction, Steps to Christ is basically all about Christianity, what it means to be a Christian. It's steps to Christ, which include the event and the process. It includes coming to know who Christ is, your initial experience of knowing who Christ is, what are those steps to know who Christ is, to accept Christ. And then it looks then at how then do you grow in Christ? So in other words, steps to Christ, in other words, coming to Christ or steps to Christ is an ongoing process. You start and you continue. You are always coming to Christ. Matthew 11, 28, come unto me and I'll give you rest. It's not something you do once. You do it every day. You come to Christ every day. You come to Christ every day. And so Steps to Christ is looking at that. It is, in a nutshell, it's what Christianity is all about. Our coming to Christ, our understanding who Christ is. It's basically we're looking at fundamentals, the basic tenets, the basic nuts and bolts of what it means to be a Christian. It's very important. And I've realized that at times we get involved and we engage in the thick and complex subjects like millennium, state of the dead, the second coming of Christ, Daniel 2, the book of Revelation. Those are very important, but we tend to miss those because we don't understand the times or rightly appreciate those steps to Christ. So I know we have all kinds of challenges, but for this week, I would like us to focus on just trying to remind ourselves what it means to come to Christ. So here we begin our journey. We're going to run quickly. The book can be downloaded. You can ask questions if you don't know how to get the book, because I want you to read the book before so we can quickly run through and summarize the book in the morning. We can't spend as much time as we'd like to. So the first chapter of the book is God's love for man. That's chapter one. And we're only going to focus on chapter one this morning, God's love for man. Now, this is appropriately the best place to start. If you're going to talk about Christianity, if you want to talk about how to get to Christ, you need to first of all understand God's love for man. The Bible is all about God's love for man. The Bible is a revelation. It is an unfolding, an explanation of who God is and how he loves man. That is the foundation. Actually, to be honest with you, everything in the Bible is supposed to help us understand who God is. Not just in essence who God is big, is almighty, but the character of God, everything in the Bible. So when you read the Bible, your question should be, what do I learn about God here? What do I get to understand about God in this story, in this passage, in this event, in this experience? The Bible is a love book. It is a book written by a God who loves us, to his children that he loves, and to explain to them who God is and what he wants for them and how he wants them to grow. And how you, of course, we may think that the Bible is there to tell us how we should behave so that one day we can be in heaven. Well, that's there on the margin. But when you understand who God is, you learn to appreciate the Bible as we should. So the first chapter, the first line, as you look at the first chapter, start with the following sentence: nature and revelation alike testify of God's love. So we're going to look at two things. We're going to spend our time on revelation. Revelation basically means the Bible. The Bible is what we call the special revelation. The Bible testifies of God's love. Not only the Bible. In other words, even if you don't have the Bible for whatever reason, you can still, by looking at nature, come to understand, not maybe in a very detailed and very clear way, but you can have an idea that whoever created this nature must be a loving God, just looking at nature. Of course, the next sentence says that the sunshine and the rain that gladden and refresh the earth, the hills and seas and plains all speak to us of the Creator's love. We still go out to nature today and sit there and feel relieved and refreshed, and we take our retreat, and there's something that speaks to us when we are in nature. Yes, of course, as you see in Genesis 3:16, that as we read in the Bible, that nature was also cursed because of man's sin. But in spite of that, we still go out to nature, and something comes out to us that whoever created this must be a loving God, must be a lover of beauty. And we get refreshed because of the exposure to nature. Of course, like I've just said, there are thorns and thistles. There are things that look not good in nature. You see animals eating each other, devouring each other. You see predators and all of that. But in spite of that, so you see the next sentence is the difficulties and the, let me remove this, the difficulties and trials that makes man's life one of toil and care were appointed for his good as a part of the training needful in God's plan for his uplifting from the ruin and degradation that sin has wrought. So even the difficulties we have, ugly as they are also, if look from a different perspective, are there to help us grow and understand who God is, even through those difficulties. And you will see, I mean, we've been listening to many speakers say that even through pain, that sometimes we can get blessings even as we experience difficulties, that difficulties can actually increase our endurance, our patience, and even our understanding of God. As Paul says in Romans 8, that all things work for good to those who love God. And in the end, in all the experiences we go through, we can even get to know who God is. We're not trying to glorify pain and suffering. Here's the last one in this slide. The world, though fallen, is not all sorrow and misery. In nature itself are messages of hope and comfort. There are flowers upon the thistles, and the thorns are covered with roses. You can decide then to spend your time looking at the thorns and the thistles, but there are also flowers. In other words, this life is, now people who have a problem with God, by the way, will point out the negative, those thorns, and say, look at the thorns. But if you're going to spend your time on the thorns, you are going to have a thorny outlook in life. But there are flowers to balance that. We're not saying there are no thorns, but there are flowers that speak to something, that something happened in nature. It doesn't, these thorns and these other negative things don't look like they were supposed to be here. Something must have happened, because you can see that these are there to tarnish and blemish the what we see. So they cannot be original, if I could use that word. So that God's love shines through even in spite of of those painful things we see in nature. Exodus 33, 18 and 19. Now we come to Revelation. We come to the Bible, God's special revelation. It says that Moses asked God, he says, please show me your glory. Please show me your glory. And God answers in Exodus 33, 18 and 19, I will make all my goodness pass before thee. Now, what is beautiful is that up until this time, if I could say that, we know that God loves us. If you read the book of Genesis in creation, and even the fall, you don't hear an expression that says, I love you, or God loves you. But you can see there in the events that are unfolding, that are revealed to us, that this must be a God of love, a God who creates us, even though he does not need us. He creates us because he loves us. Remember, guys, we are the product of love. God did not create us and then fell in love with us. He fell in love with us, if I could use the word. He loved us in our non-existence. And it was that love that brought us into existence. So God's love is not a reaction to us, to the object, to our existence. And he says, let me love them. They are here. Like some parents who, for some reason, end up having children when they did not plan for them, and then end up having to love them because they are there. But with God, it's different. We are here because God loves us. We are the product of love. Before we were, there was God's love. And that love, which is who God is, brought us into existence. So our creation, and not only that, the way we were created, God gave us a choice whether we want to follow him or not by planting the tree in the Garden of Eden. And that the fact of choice also speaks to the fact that God loves us, beloved, because where there is choice, you can't love where there's no choice. Otherwise, you're just a zombie, an automaton. Not only that, the fall of man, that when man fell into sin, sometimes you know how one loves you by the way he reacts when you have sinned, when you have done something wrong to him. We see God not fuming, not coming with consuming fire to destroy Adam and Eve. He comes in a still small voice and he speaks to them and he tells them his provision, how he's going to bring an end to sin. So all of those things, even though the word love is not used, but we can see that we're dealing with a God, with a unique God. By the way, when we say that God loves men, God loves men, it's something so profound, so radical that even other gods of other religions never even intimate that. Because to have a God who loves men is a God who's confined. You limit God when you say God loves you. That is why, humanly speaking, God should not love us. Because when God loves us, he is saying, there are things you cannot do and I cannot stop you because you have chosen to do those things. Because naturally, a God should be able to do whatever he wants. He should be able to get to receive whatever he wants. But God cannot receive your allegiance, your worship, if you don't want. If you don't want to worship him, you can choose not to. And then that limits God. But the false gods will never allow you that. That's why they don't use the word love. But this God loves us. He's even willing to accept our rejection. God's love is stronger than our rejection. He's even willing to expose himself to the possibility that we may not love him back, as we see in the book of Genesis. Let's quickly run. We're going to run out of time. So he says, Moses says, show me your glory. And God says, I'll make all my goodness pass before thee. And then in chapter 34, it says, this is his glory. The Lord passed before Moses and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity, one, transgression, two, and sin, three. And all those are different shades of what sin is. In Hebrew, those three are different words. It's not just sin, there's iniquity. It includes rebellion. It includes breaking God's law. It includes sinfulness. All the types and the shades of sin. This God says, I forgive iniquity. It's not someone who says this about God. It is God who says that. God is bragging about his willingness to forgive. I'm a forgiving God. There are very few people who can say that I'm a forgiving parent, I'm a forgiving mother, I'm a forgiving father, I'm a forgiving friend. That's who he is. Jonah did not want to go to Tarshish. And he says, the reason I did not want to go there, it is because I know who you are. You are a God who's slow to anger. You are a God who's abundant in chesed, in loving kindness, loving, profound understanding there of love. Of God's love, a God who's abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. And Micah says, you delight in mercy. You find joy in being merciful. Now, though all these evidence have been given, the enemy, which is Satan, he has blinded the minds of men so that they looked upon God with fear. They thought of him as severe and unforgiving. One of Satan's delight is to present a false God. Today, we've got atheist people who say they don't believe in God. And the reason they don't believe in God mostly is that this God is a cruel God, is a maniac, is a God who wants to destroy, is a God who wants to kill people. And the people says, no, we'll have nothing to do with God. But this is a misrepresentation, which is the greatest problem. Darkness that covers the world is the misrepresentation of God. So you've got Christians who fall in love with this kind of a God, who fall in love with a God who's severe and unforgiving, exacting, a cruel God. They said, let's worship this God. Otherwise, if we don't, we are going to burn in hell forever and then rest on Sunday. We grew up being told that rest on Sunday, and then on Monday, he burns you forever. And then they said, let's worship him. So they worship God out of fear. Now, but what happens is if you worship a cruel God, a God who has a bad character, you will also develop that character. So that is why at times you'll find that if you keep on being obsessed and worshiping a God who does not love, it will be difficult for you to have love because you can never be better than God. So Satan has led men to conceive of God as a being whose chief attribute is stern justice, a God who's a severe judge, a harsh, exacting creditor. He pictured the creator as being who's watching with jealous eye to discern the errors and mistakes of men, that he may visit judgments upon them. Some of us, when we are going through difficulties, we say, the Lord is punishing me. The Lord is punishing me. He's killing my children. He's taking my money. He's inflicting me with pain. We've got those wrong images about who God is. It was to remove this dark shadow by revealing to the world the infinite love of God that Jesus came to live among men. The Son of God came from heaven to make manifest the Father. John 1:18, no man had seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father. He had declared him, Matthew 11:27, neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. And when they asked in John 14:89, show us the Father, Jesus answered, have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that had seen me had seen the Father, and how sayest thou then that show us the Father? So in other words, what Christ is saying here is, sometimes we say we love Christ, but the God in the Old Testament is a cruel God, but Christ is a loving Son. So Christ is protecting us from the Father. We love Christ, but we have a problem with his Father. But Christ is saying, no, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. So Christ came to correct the wrong concept, the wrong view of God. He says, this is who God is. If you love Christ, then that's who God is. Whatever you see Christ doing, when you see Christ weeping, that's God weeping. When you see Christ feeding the thousands of people, that's God doing that. When you see Christ healing the sick, that is God doing that. When you see Christ resurrecting the dead, that is God. When you see Christ saying in John 10:10, I have come that you might have love, you might have a life abundantly, that is God speaking. When Christ says the thief comes to kill, to steal, kill, and destroy, he is referring to the devil, not to Christ. Christ came and resurrected Lazarus, and the sister says, if you were here, Lazarus would not have died, which means Christ says God is for life. He wants us to live life and live it abundantly. 1 Timothy 3:16 summarizes that Christ was manifest in the flesh, and he was manifest in the flesh as a tender, pitying savior. Now that was who God is. That is who God is. Such is the character of Christ as revealed in his life. This is the character of God. It is from the Father's heart that the streams of divine compassion manifest in Christ flow out to the children of men. Now, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Now, here's the beautiful part. It was not because Christ died for us that God loves us. Actually, he sent him because he loves us. I like that statement there. I'm not reading everything. We're running out of time. The last part there says, the Father loves us not because of the great sacrifice that he made. He provided the sacrifice, that is Christ dying for the propitiation, because he loves us. Christ was the medium. Listen to that. Christ was the medium through which he could pour out his infinite love upon a fallen world. So Christ is the conduit of God's love for man. Behold, what manner of love the Father bestowed upon us, beloved, that we should be called the sons of God. What a value this places upon men. Through transgression, the sons of men became subjects of Satan. Now, but through faith in the atoning sacrifice of Christ, the sons of Adam can now become the sons of God. By assuming human nature, Christ elevates humanity. Fallen men are placed where through connection with Christ, they may indeed become worthy to be called the sons of God. And in conclusion, the more we study the divine character in the light of the cross, the more we see mercy, tenderness, forgiveness blended with equity and justice. And the more clearly we discern innumerable evidences of a love that is infinite and a tender pity surpassing a mother's yearning sympathy for her wayward child. Now, let me tell you something. Welcome to Steps to Christ. This is just the introduction. We are going to see this love unfolding in the next steps that we're going to look at. All the steps will reveal only one thing, that God loves us, beloved. When we talk about confession, when you talk about how to grow in Christ, when you talk about the privilege of prayer, you will see God's love being unfolded. This is going to be an amazing, amazing journey for all of us, myself included. I cannot wait. I'm so excited. But get this thing today as you start the day. Happy Sunday to everyone. God loves you. No matter who you are, no matter what your color is, your status in life, you must know this one thing. You may not have experienced love from your father, from your parents. You may be having challenges with your relationship with your children, with your parents, with your partner. But let me tell you something today, which is the foundation, the bedrock of your life. God loves you. The creator of the universe is madly in love with you. He is love. He loves you with love that is unconditional. He does not love you because you are behaving very well. He loves you because he defines what love is. And may God bless you. Let us pray together. Our kind and loving Father, we thank you, Lord, once more for reminding us, in a nutshell, who you are, that we worship a God who is a loving God. And our prayer is, as we bask in the presence of that God, as we look and watch who you are and admiring your character, may it reflect, may it shine also from our character, so that we can also be loving Christians, which is the most powerful argument, loving, lovable Christians, so that we can share that love with those around us, because we worship a God who loves us. Thank you very much, and thank you for this day. May you bless us and bless all of us. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen.